welcome to 5 in 5 Minutes with the Frazier. Today we're talking about the top 5 hidden figures in the bourbon industry. First up, we have Maria the Jewess. Maria was considered an alchemist. She lived in the first century Egypt. And alchemy in this case just means taking one natural resource and turning it into something else. So in Maria's case, she was taking fermented fruits and turning that into brandy. The Latin was aqua vitae, or the water of life. And Maria is credited with creating the very first alembic still. What's so important is that she created something so simple and so reliable that stills actually haven't changed much over the course of their existence. And today you can see stills of a similar shape, size, etc., serving the same scientific function in distilleries today. Next, let's bring it back to Kentucky with Catherine Spears Fry Carpenter. Catherine Carpenter was credited with writing down the very first sour mash recipe, or mash bill, for whiskey. Sour mash takes part of the yeast or fermentation from the last batch that you made and puts it into the new batch of whiskey that you're making. Whereas before, the mash bill was mostly just sweet mash, meaning you start over from scratch every single time you make a new batch of whiskey. Catherine wrote down her mash bill in 1818, and it still exists at the Filson Historical Society today in their archives. Now Catherine is buried in Henderson County. Catherine represents a really important group of people. In the frontier days, bourbon was distilled mostly by women and enslaved people because distilling was considered a domestic task. And so most bourbon was created in small batches, and it was created for domestic use only. Next, let's talk about Prohibition era Kentucky. Mary Dowling was credited with sidestepping Prohibition completely by moving her distillery from Anderson County, Kentucky, all the way to Juarez, Mexico. I have a whole video on her, which will be linked in the description. Her story is really fascinating. She was running Waterfill and Frazier at the time, which she had inherited from her husband who passed away, and she had gone through all of her options before deciding to finally move her entire operation to a different country. First, she tried to apply for a medicinal whiskey license, which was unfortunately turned down. Next, she tried to sell off as many barrels as she could to other distilleries who could possibly use them, including pharmaceutical companies. And one of those families was Pappy Van Winkle. If you're into bourbon, you know that name. She resorted to bootlegging once the Volstead Act finally passed. In 1924, she was finally busted and she was taken to court. Mary and her sons decided to continue running their operation, but obviously they couldn't continue doing it here in Kentucky. So they enlisted the help of Joseph Beam of the Jim Beam family to move their distillery to Juarez, Mexico, where they ended up serving the Mexican market and Central America, and also hosted a lot of thirsty tourists coming across the border. The 1950s were a landmark decade in the bourbon industry because marketing completely changed the game. The wife of Bill Samuels, who was the master distiller at Maker's Mark at the time, had a genius marketing idea. She noticed in her pewter collection that the best makers would always stamp their name into the pewter as their signature or maker's mark, and that's where the name came from. Next, she took a note from her cognac collection in their living room and noticed the wax dripping on the top. Wax dipping wasn't new, but it was new to bourbon. She realized that every bottle could have its own handcrafted signature if every bottle was hand-dipped into red wax, which is where the iconic red wax Maker's Mark bottles come from today. And finally, that brings us to the modern age in the bourbon industry. I wanted to mention Joy Perrine, who was the very first woman bartender in Louisville in 1978. And you might be wondering why women weren't bartending before this era. Well, legally, women were not allowed to serve alcohol before the 70s. She was also the first bartender to be credited with creating bourbon cocktails and really experimenting with bourbon. This was important because she got a lot of backlash for that. Before, the only really accepted bourbon cocktails were mint juleps and old fashions, which had been around for decades. And she had a really long, prolific career at Equus and Jack's Lounge for over 30 years. So if you're from Louisville, perhaps you've been served by Joy. Unfortunately, she passed away last year, but more information about her is available in the Gracious Table here in the Spirit of Kentucky exhibit. For when we reopen, you're welcome to come and visit yourself. So thank you guys for watching today's top five. I hope you learned something new about bourbon, and we'll see you next time.